Hi. During this section, you will learn why encoding is such a very good thing to do, and you will learn to use XML. And you will see it's not that difficult. So why on earth people do encode their text? Why we think that encoding is the very good thing to do for editing? Because encoding allows you to describe the text for what it is and not for what it looks like, which is a smart thing to do if you want them to process their features on the text and not the way they look. It also allows to separate the text and the content of your edition from the way it looks like on the video at the end on a display, so that you can process in many ways. It's very good for long-term sustainability because it is a way for recording what you mean to do and not what you want to do right now in present. And it is not connected to a specific software. At least the kind of encoding we will show you is something that can be used over and over again. Markup and encoding is not born with computers. It's a concept that is born with printing, actually. And it is the kind of symbols and little things that editors and publishers used to put on the side of the text just to show what you wanted to do with that. So to show if you want to make it bigger, smaller, and italics, etc. So you know all the little symbols you put around the page when you copy edit, when you proofread things, you say you want to correct things? Yes, that's markup, actually. You can also call punctuation and the layout of the page some sort of markup, because that allows you to understand how to segment your text and what to do with that. There is also a more specialized type of markup. For instance, maybe some of you will be familiar with the so-called Leiden convention, which is a series of codes and encodings that are used by scholars of papyruses for making an edition of that, and epigraphies, to show damages on the material, to show what they have done with that, their interpretation of it. You'll see some of the symbols they use on the screen right now. Here the example is a page from Les Fleurs du Mal, the first version of Les Fleurs du Mal by Baudelaire, and there are corrections made by the author that was telling to his publisher how to modify the page to his liking and to correct the text in some cases. All those symbols, tags. All the ensemble of the tags, markup. And but markup, as I said, is not just that. It's also everything we use to make the text more readable. If we had to read the text in the way the Romans would write in, that would be very difficult, because in centuries, and actually millennia, we have added layers and layers of markup to our text to make it more readable. So spacing, capital letters, bold, italics, punctuation, everything that we call we use will make it readable. So XML. XML is technology we will show you. And why it is? Because it is very easy to learn, because it's very portable, and because it's been around for a little bit now. And so we have some kind of hope they will last for a long time. It has been created and maintained by the W3C, World Wide Web Consortium, in 1996, with a strong contribution of the digital humanities community, and particularly of the Text Encoding Initiative. XML is made of two main components. First, the first component is called elements. So what are elements? Is everything you can put a label on it, everything you will describe somehow, everything that you think it's important to annotate in your text. And the way it looks is the way you see on the screen. There is a start tag, which is composed by an angle bracket, the name of your tag and another angle bracket to close it, the content of your element, and your end tag, which is identical to the start tag, but there is a slash just before the tag name. Sometimes elements can be empty, that is, they don't have any content. In that case, you will have only one tag and a slash immediately after the element name, in which way you kind of condensate the start and the end tag into one. How to use elements? Elements are can be one after the other, so they can be in a sequence, or they can nest, meaning that you can use an element within another element. But one basic rule that can never be bent is they cannot overlap, meaning that if you open an element A and you all open element B, then you have to close B before you can close A. And this is always true. You can never bend this rule. You also need an element that wraps the entire files that we call the root element. The beginning and the end of everything is within the same element. The second part of XML is attributes. What is an attribute? It is something that we use to specify something about an element, to classify, to give a detail, to make it more clear. You see here in the example, we have the sentence, the Prime Minister during World War II. And if you are an expert on the history of World War II and you know that the context we are talking about is the one in the United Kingdom, you will know that there were two prime ministers. And you may know which moment of the history of the war we are talking about. So you may say, oh, yes, I know who is it. It's Winston Churchill. So there you have it. You use the markup to add information to your text, something that you as an expert on the field know and the computer cannot know automatically. We have here in this example two attributes. The attribute reg, that is used to regularize the reference to the name, which is Winston Churchill. But the order is Churchill, comma Winston. And we use that because after we will use that for creating an automatic index of name. And also we have an attribute type that say which type of reference it is. It is to a person. You see also the syntax of that. After the element name, there is a white space, obligatory, the name of your element, followed by a sign of equal, and the value of the attribute is in between quotes. You can have as many attributes as you want in your element, but the same attribute can only be used once. So that's it. You have learned XML. Didn't I tell you it was easy?